Willkommen, bienvenue, welcome. I'm the Associate Executive Director of Canada FBM 2021, and this afternoon we have the honor to have Vivek Chraya with us on stage to discuss about poetry with Dirk Huilstruck. Je suis très heureuse que Vivek ait pu faire le voyage jusqu'à Francfort pour être avec nous et vous aujourd'hui. I think she will be the literary crush of many of you this week. So, therefore, there will be a book signing after this session in the foyer. Donc, sans plus tarder, I will ask them to please join me on stage. Et je vous souhaite une bonne séance. Have a wonderful session.
Yeah, I'm very pleased that we can be here now. I think some of you have already seen Vivek Chraya, maybe on the opening ceremony of the book fair or on Canada Night. For those of you who haven't seen Vivek Chraya, maybe just a few words about her. You're a really multidisciplinary artist, a musician, a writer, I think even a teacher of creative writing, filmmaker. You're also on covers of magazines, and you're into fashion very much.
I don't know how to juggle, though.
Yeah,
just you don't know how to juggle. That's one thing I don't know how to do.
Actually, I was thinking about, is there something missing you can't do, you know?
You know, I did a play last year. I feel like I was one of the only people during COVID that got to do a play somehow. It happened in February, right before the pandemic hit.
Yeah.
And we had a choreographer. And you know how you think inside you have a latent talent? You're like, oh yeah, I can probably do this. And I'm like, I'm a performer, blah, blah, blah. I can dance. And then the choreographer showed up and I was like, I had zero moves. So, I mean, that's something an aspiring dancer just wish, that's on the wish list. And sculpture. So next time you bring me sculpture.
Okay, next time it's for sculpture.
Yeah.
Definitely. I think you must be one of the persons who are most busy here on the book fair, because you have so many shows going on, so many performances, so many interviews. We already had an interview today.
It's true. And are you sick of me
it's
yet?
It's our second meeting. Our second meeting. And I think right now our idea was to talk, how to manage all these ideas as a multidisciplinary artist. How is all this kind of art connected with each other? And maybe it's a good start to go back to the opening night. You had this speech on identity and identities. And maybe you can explain a little bit about it. What was your main idea about identity on the opening night?
Yeah, I mean, when we hear this phrase, singular plurality, I think for me as a human, I think about the ways that I encompass many different people in one. So I'm not just one thing, I'm many things. So whether that's being brown, whether that's being trans, whether that's being Albertan, whether it's being an Aquarius, any Aquariuses in the room? Yes? Okay, great. We feel passionately about each other. so all of the, I feel like I encompass all of those things in one. And so I think for me, one of my personal agendas is trying to get people to embrace all the people that we are, all the people that you are, all the people that you are, instead of just this idea of just being a singular self.
So that's also a little bit connected about the idea of self-expression. So if you want to express yourself, you have to find out who you are, actually. And so how does that connect to the self-expression? Because if you think you are many identities, so expression multiplies as well.
It's true, yeah. But I think that's the thing, is this idea you have to figure out who you are. And I'm like, no, you don't have to figure it out. You can just keep experimenting. Yeah. And that every layer is a new self, as opposed to being like, oh, I'm trying this on or I'm trying this on. It's like all of those things are valid. Every person that you are, every step that you travel is another aspect of who you are.
Mm. And as an artist, as far as I know, you really started out as a musician.
Yeah.
And aspiring to be a big pop star.
Just like Madonna.
Just like Madonna. Yeah. And so that was your first, artistic identity as a musician. So how did you start as a musician?
The way that I started was that my mom actually, she used to sing these beautiful Indian songs in the house, and so she actually taught me how to sing that, and so I have such a huge gratitude for her. And then the other way that I learned music is that in junior high and high school, I used to get picked on a lot, and so I used to pay attention to what the popular girls were into, and they were really into pop music, and so I'd watch what they would listen to. I don't know if this is a too Western reference, but they were really into this song by Vanessa Williams, Save the Best for Last. I'm really dating myself. Okay, thank you. You went and saved the best for last. Anyone? No? Well, but so I would listen to what they were listening to, and then I would go to the library, and I would take out cassettes by Vanessa Williams. I would learn the song, and then anytime I would see them in the hallway, I would just start humming it. I would just... And they were so impressed. They were like, oh my God, you sing, blah, blah, blah. And they took me under their wing, and then they protected me from bullies. So the reason why I got into music originally was actually as a protective mechanism. I think that if you're queer or racialized, you actually have to be very creative about how you survive in the world. So that's how I first got into music.
And also, maybe part of that identity is that you come from a Indian Hindu family, immigrant family. And how much did this affect your music, basically?
I mean, completely. Like, learning Indian music first, I think, you know, it's really affected how I sing, the kind of music that I'm into. Like, when I first started hearing R&B music, I was so drawn to it because R&B, Indian music is about, like, stuffing as many notes in, like, as many seconds as possible. So you don't just go, like, Indian music's like, Like, it's like just like you stuff it. And R&B music is actually like that, too. It's so beautiful, right? Like, when you hear, like, Whitney Houston sing, she's doing, like, 15 notes in one bar. And so for me, it was growing up in Indian music
it's
that I was,
embellished,
like,
yeah,
when I hear Mariah Carey or I hear, you know, Whitney Houston, I'm like, oh, this sounds like Indian music to me. So I think that's had a huge impact on me as well.
Oh, that's a really an interesting connection you make there between the black music and the Indian music.
Totally.
Yeah. So that's really interesting. But then you pursued your career as a musician for a while, and I think you were not unsuccessful, but then at some point you decided there must be something else, is it? Like this?
Yeah, so I didn't quite become Madonna, as you can tell. maybe later in life. But I then decided that I needed to take a break from music because it just, I don't know how many of you have had that experience where you try and turn an art form into a career. It's not a good idea sometimes. And so what happened to me is then I felt like I had to take a break from music. It was like a breakup. I used to call it a breakup. And when I took a breakup, that's actually when I started writing my first short stories, which then I self-published into a book called God Loves Hair. And that book suddenly took off, and there was so much interest in it, and it made me rethink who I was. I was like, again, this idea of selves. I was like, maybe I'm not just a musician. Maybe I'm also a writer. And now I'm here with you.
And to start here as writing, is it really self-taught, or did you go to any creative writing courses? I know you're teaching creative writing right now.
It's true. So I mentioned this last night, so I don't like to actually say this, but I'll tell you the story again for those of you that missed it. I actually went, my major in university was English, but I don't like giving them too much credit because my English teacher at the university, once he found me in a hallway and he lectured me for an hour, I'm not joking, for an hour, and told me that I was a terrible writer. This is probably not a good thing to tell of you, but he was like, you're a terrible writer. Your career is not going to go anywhere. So now I love when the university brings me back to do talks because I always like to start by being like, so there was this time I went to school here. but yeah, so that's sort of like how, so technically I was trained, I guess, but I don't like to give them too much credit.
Okay, very good. I think a lot of really good writers came out from being bad at school or at university, actually. So it's quite common. I think you published maybe like a dozen albums, music albums, and now as much or as many books. So it's really like a second career. And of course, it's not only books, but even within the literary career, you're really diverse. You wrote children's book, I think.
Yeah, a children's book. I've written a novel. I've written a book of poetry. Haven't done a romance novel yet.
Yeah.
Haven't done mystery. So I'm like just keeping my
science fiction.
That's my next one. Science fiction.
I hope so. I really hope so.
No, I'm not even joking. It's actually happening.
Okay. Science
fiction poetry. Yeah.
Yeah. So it's really. It looks like you really want to try out everything is possible in within that art form. Is that like this?
Or that's exactly it. Like
so
for me,
you don't continue one thing; you just go on to the next step.
I flicked my hair, and then the mic fell off. See, it's hazardous. I mean, for me, I just love trying things. I love experimenting. I also love flexing my creative muscle, and I feel like the only way that you learn how to be an artist is by trying. Yeah. That's why I'm sort of like. Not anti-school, please don't tweet that because I'll get fired from my job. But I really believe that you can learn everything just by trying. And the more I, you know, when I write poetry, that informs my songwriting. And when I try songwriting, informs like being a theater artist. And doing theater makes me better at doing Zoom events, believe it or not. So, you know, every skill builds on each other. And that's why I love trying so many things.
Yeah, I think that's the interesting part. It's not really separate art forms, but you really try to combine it or use one thing as a step for the next one.
Exactly.
You made a book with that goes along with a music album,
the
Subtweet. We just discussed that on the radio. And now you brought another book with you. And
I'm Afraid of Men. In the back it says Men.
Yeah, and you're
men
sitting next to me. I'm sorry if you're too afraid of me. But you just told me there's also some connection to music.
Yeah.
So this is very much about your identity and your biography, but it's also connected to music. And you brought
guitar. Yeah, I'm going to do a little song for you.
Yeah, yeah. Please do.
So... I made an album in 2017 called Part-Time Woman, and I just come out as transgender, and so the album was really inspired. Again, I'm a 90s kid, so I don't know how many of these references, and I don't know how much these references translate to Germany, but I grew up like listening to Sheryl Crow and Tori Amos and PJ Harvey, and I felt such a huge debt to them as an artist because, you know, so many women artists, Salt and Peppa, you know, they were talking about some pretty incredible things in pop music in the 90s. So, you know, whether it was about abortion or miscarriage or rape. And so when I was writing this album, I felt like I wanted to, like, give back. And it's like, how could I give back to this genre of feminist musician artists? And so when I wrote Part-Time Woman, maybe I'll sing a song from Part-Time Woman, then I'll tell you how it evolved into a book. I don't shave, I don't wear makeup, no skirts, I don't dress up. What doesn't make me, doesn't make me a part-time woman. How many high notes do you have to reach? How many hours do you have to plead? Oh, will I always be a part-time woman? I don't shave, I don't wear lipstick, I'm not polished. I don't fix it. What doesn't make me, doesn't make me a part-time woman. Yeah. How much weight do you have to lose? How many hours do you have to prove? Or am I just doomed as a part-time woman? Part-time woman, don't you know? No one can tell you what you already know. If you only could let go. I don't shave, I don't wear makeup. Thank you. So I wrote this album, and then there was a song on the album called I'm Afraid of Men. And when you put out an album, usually There's everyone has a song that they like, right? Like on the new Ariana Grande album, it's like, this is a song I like or whatever. But I'm Afraid of Men was the one song nobody liked. No one said anything about that song. Maybe the title was too scary for them, but no one said anything. And then I felt like there was more that I wanted to explore about this idea. And so I ended up writing a long form essay, which got published, called I'm Afraid of Men, which sort of explored this idea more. So, I mean, for me, one of the things that's interesting about art is sometimes you think maybe it's a song, and then actually it's like, no, maybe it's also a book. So that, again, that theme of singular plurality comes up again in my work, where it's like, it's not just exploring in one medium, but sometimes exploring in multimediums.
Yeah, and in the beginning, you sometimes don't know which medium.
Exactly.
It will end
exactly.
Up.
Yeah. So maybe the song was terrible, and it was better to write the book.
I must admit, when I saw the title of the book, I was a bit afraid of that too. You know?
What were you afraid of?
I'm not quite sure what is behind the title, but I'm sure you will tell us a little bit.
Men are afraid of me.
Men are afraid of you. Well, that's it. Exactly. Exactly. And. But tell us a little bit more about the book. What is your idea about the book? And it's a kind of a biographical book, is it?
Yeah. So, I mean, I wrote it during Me Too in 2018, around that time. And I felt like so much of the... Sorry, I'm looking at you, and then I'm looking at everyone. I don't want you to think it's not because I don't want to look at you. But
yeah,
I just want to make sure that I'm keeping you interested as well. So I wrote it during Me Too because I felt like so much of the narrative that was happening in Me Too centered a particular kind of woman. So it was usually white women that were sort of dominating that conversation. And I felt like as a trans person, I had this unique experience as someone who had been raised as a boy, so had, you know, experienced what it was like to grow up that way, but then also had experienced misogyny through homophobia, and now have a totally different experience as a trans person and being a person of color. And so it felt interesting to sort of look at masculinity through the lens of a trans person of color, to complicate the conversations of Me Too that were happening at the time.
I think that's really a true thing you said. It complicated. Yeah, just reading it, it looks really like a very complicated existence sometimes you will have in between all these kind of things, but also really, really interesting to have these different perspectives from both sides, which is, I think we once said, it's also a gift to have this.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. I mean, I think everyone should be trans because, I mean, it's funny, but like part of me just feels like I have learned so much about misogyny and sexism and what it means to be a girl in the world that I would have never ever learned without being trans. Like, I mean, there's superficial observations. Like, for instance, when you go to a shop, this is very superficial, so I apologize to the women and the femmes in the room, but like the same shirt that you can buy in a men's section for $20 is literally $80 in the women's section. I have no idea why that is, but it's because, well, I know why that is. It's because like women run the economy essentially, but all jokes aside, like I've just learned so much. And I feel really grateful for the experience of transness because it's given me a perspective that I would not have had otherwise.
Mm-hmm. And so what would your clue be on masculinity? How do you think it has to change, or how should it change?
Ooh, Dirk.
Well, I'll
start
out of interest,
from page one. No, I mean, for me, what's interesting too, like, one of the things I don't like is some people will say to me, I love your book, I hate men. And it's like, no, I didn't write that book. Mm. Like, for me, the complicated aspect of this book is, what does it mean to love men, which I do, and to be afraid? Both of those things can be true, right? And I think people see I'm Afraid of Men and they immediately imagine it's like very aggressive or something. But for me, the tension of this book is, what does it mean to reconcile both desire and attraction? And what that means is that we're all part of that story, right? I could have written a book that was like, this is why men suck, but I'm not interested in that story. Mm. I'm interested in how are we all part of what makes masculinity hard, including me, right? So in this book, I talk about the ways that, you know, a lot of people think that if you're a gay man, you're not sexist. But like, I've gone to gay bars and gay men feel like it's okay to grab women's bodies because they'll say, oh, no, it's fine, I'm gay. And it's like, well, no, you still don't get to just grab a woman's body, right? So this is what I mean when I say every person in the world, has a responsibility and role in fixing sexism, in addressing misogyny, in addressing the patriarchy. And so that's what this book is trying to get to, if that makes sense.
Yeah, definitely. And
so it's not just on you, okay? So you can go to bed okay.
Yeah. No, but what I can totally understand is the need that we are able to change perspectives. And probably everyone has masculine and feminine sides inside, you know, mixed and to a certain extent, and so it's just a matter of looking for that, you know, and to find out.
I didn't have to look so hard.
Yeah, it's and there's one thing that I'm also interested in. You said your hair has a really a big role in your, well, your art, your identity. Yeah, of course, you can see that. How come? What is the role of hair for you?
I mean, I think if you look at a lot of, like, especially POC communities, BIPOC communities, like, hair just is such a central part, is so connected to identity. Mm. I think for me, you know, there's obviously the superficial aspects of hair that's, like, tied to gender. But for me, one of the things I find really interesting is, like, my origin story, if you will. My mom, because of the experiences of sexism and misogyny she experienced in India, when she came to Canada, she was very clear that she wanted boys. She did not want to have girls, which to me is heartbreaking, right? To be a woman and be like, I do not want to have a girl in the world. And so what she did is she prayed. And in, like, Hinduism is all about bartering with God. You're like, if I do this, you can give me this, right? So it's like she basically said to God, if you give me two boys, I will shave their heads, their first haircuts in India at this temple. There's a special temple in India where people, if they want a job, they shave their head. If they want a wife, they shave their head. It's like, because they believe that hair is what makes you beautiful. And so if you give up your hair, it's the ultimate sacrifice. So my mom said, if I get two boys, I will take them to India and shave their heads. Notice how she promised our hair, not her own hair, right? And so she had me, and but then because they're Indian and they're immigrants, they're like, we should save our money. Let's not wait. Let's make another baby before we go to India. So for 2 years, I had very long hair because Indian hair grows very fast. So for the first 2 years of my life, most people confused me for a girl, which I think is very interesting in terms of thinking about gender being a social construct. But anyways, so this is one of the things I find really, I think the reason why I returned to hair is just because that's such a big part of my, like, origin story. And the fact that even though my mom prayed and prayed and prayed to get boys, and technically, on a biological level, that's what she got. Despite that, I have persisted, if you will. So, yeah, I think that's one of the reasons why hair is so important to me.
Yeah, and your first book is also titled
God Loves Hair, which is about that sort of story.
Yeah, so you get this kind of story. And you also have a lot of other projects and books with you. I think on the next performance we will meet at, you're displaying another book you wrote.
Even This Page Is White.
Even This Page Is White, which is about racial and skin color issues.
Yeah. Exactly. So if you're not tired of me, tomorrow at 5 o'clock, I'm going to do poetry for you.
Yeah.
Still no juggling, but poetry.
Yeah. No juggling, but poetry. Well, it's kind of a word juggling anyway.
Yes.
And of course, maybe for the finish, I would like to ask is for the writing part, you already named some inspirations for your music. But for the writing, did you have any role models for the writing?
Yeah, so I mean, there's two artists in particular who I credit for becoming a writer or being inspired to write. One was, I took this class in university, again, too much credit to university, but it was on Oprah, and I was like, oh, this will be an easy A. Again, I don't know if you've had that experience where you're looking through the course catalog and you're like, which one can I get a fast A on? And I was like, the Oprah course, I'll definitely get good on that. And that course changed my life because we actually had to read Oprah's book club, and it was the first time, to my knowledge, that I read a person of color, a black woman by the name of Toni Morrison. I read The Bluest Eye, and just like saying her name just gives me chills. But that book was the first time that I can remember in my entire education that I read a person of color in school. So that's 15 years into my education. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if you've had that experience where you don't realize something's missing until you see it. And when I read Toni Morrison's Bluest Eye, even though I'm not black, just seeing the experience of racism written on a page and just seeing the experience of someone who isn't white written on the page, it inspired me so much. And then many years later, well, not many years later, about 10 years later, I read a book by Leslie Feinberg called Stone Butch Blues. And I had a very similar experience because this was the first time I'd read a book by an LGBTQ author. And that book, I remember crying on the plane and just being like, I wish I'd found this book when I was 16. And so I think the combination of reading Toni Morrison and Leslie Feinberg made me want to tell my story.
Okay, well, that's a good idea. And so if you're interested in more, hearing more of Vivek Schreier tomorrow at 5 o'clock, same stage here, there is a kind of a performance.
Yeah, a performance. I'll talk less.
Yes.
I'll perform more.
I'll make a short introduction, then you'll do your performance.
Yeah.
Right, yeah. And there's also a talk we made on Radio X today, which is a small Frankfurt radio station, Radio X, you can find on the internet. And it's also in English, and it will be online for the next 7 days there. So people can listen to that also on Radio X, our talk. And also a song you played.
Yeah, I did.
There's a couple of songs you played, actually. Yeah, yeah. So please listen to that. And you're really so busy, and I hope you can find a little bit of sleep the next days also. Well, good luck to all of your performances and shows, and
thank you so much.
Great to have you here. It really appreciate.
Thank you, and I just want to thank all of you for being here. I haven't been able to perform for like a year and a half, and it feels like such a joy to be on stage. So thank you so much for giving me this opportunity. I really appreciate it.
Thank you
so much, Dirk.